Hello, my name is Dimitris Prizos, and I'm leading the Railway Engineering Research and Education Initiative at the University of South Carolina. Today, I would like to discuss and present digital image correlation technologies as we have implemented them in a number of different research projects that require data acquisition, in particular to the product development of concrete ties. So we'll start with some introductory remarks, cover the basics of digital image correlation, and then we will present implementation of the technology in three different cases of product development of concrete ties. Finish with some conclusions and thoughts on the technology. So we live in a data-driven world where information is power, and data collection through testing for properties and performance is critical in product development at a material, component, or system level, and in design certification and damage detection and monitoring once the product is in service. Such testing can take place in laboratory facilities, production facilities, or even in the field when we deal with performance and service. Took the liberty and grouped the instrumentation that is used in such activities into two broad areas, the contact systems and the vision-based systems. Contact systems such as strain gauges, LVDTs, the acoustic emission, require physical contact with a specimen, and the measurements that they acquire are typically at discrete points on the specimen. On the other hand, vision-based systems are used for feature identification, change detection, measurements of the shape and the geometry of the product, and often use 2D or 3D image processing that involves artificial intelligence and deep learning. And another group of methods, one level above that, is the digital image correlation, where in addition to shapes or identification, we compute deformations and strains. And this technology in particular is the one that we will focus in today's presentation. Digital image correlation techniques have been developed at the University of South Carolina laboratories during the last 30 years, well-established procedures that have also moved into commercial applications, spin of companies by the university. It's a non-contacting measurement technique. It's highly accurate, where we can measure as low as 5 microns, the deformations with a resolution as low as 5 microns under appropriate conditions, and strains to 10 microstrain. The method, this technology, digital image correlation, can be applied for 2D and 3D full field shape, displacement, and deformation or strain measurements in laboratory, in the field, and production facilities. It's a proven technology that has been successfully applied to other industries over the years in the aerospace, automotive, biological, industrial, material science, and so on and so forth. In the last few years, we've been implementing this in railway infrastructure. So what does it consist of? The hardware. It's basically two cameras if we're dealing with stereo systems, and a computer that does the image processing or the image correlation in particular in this case. Of course, we need the appropriate lenses, lights, filters, and a calibration target that will allow us to compute the camera parameters. This system, now the camera system, can be mounted on a stationary system or on a drone. We have successfully acquired measurements from drone-mounted DIC systems. And to the best of our knowledge, we are the first group that has presented results in this area. So how does it work? Let's take, for example, testing of a rail seat area of a pre-stressed concrete beam. The area, the surface that we need to monitor covered by a speckled pattern, and that speckled pattern has to be of high contrast. Then a pair of cameras is monitoring the area as follows. When the specimen is unloaded in the undeformed condition, or what we want to consider as a baseline, an initial set of images is taken and stored. Then load is applied and deformations are applied on the specimen moves and deforms. So both rigid body motion and deformations take place And at the default configuration, we take another set of images. Now we will be correlating the two set of images to compute deformations as follows. First, we define an area of interest on the surface that we're monitoring, and we will divide this area into subsets. So the goal is now to track each of the subsets, each and every of the subsets after deformation, and compute the movement of the center of the subset. This is done through correlating the images. And this can be done for any set of images. And once all these points have been computed, then they can be placed in a color map that represents the field, the deformation field or strains or any other derived parameter. So the camera resolution, the frequency of acquisition, frames per second, the lens size depends on the application and the required field of view. Distance of the cameras from the specimen depends now on the focal length of the lenses and the size of the area to be captured. The speckle pattern that we need to apply should be random and should be of high contrast, as the size and the density of the speckles depends on the problem particulars. And that speckle can be applied by a sprayer or a roller or a stamp, or can even be engraved on the surface. System has been validated in a number of different occasions. The first validation took place at the laboratory on a pre-stressed prismatic beam. And in particular, we monitored the strains in the surface of the beam when the strands were released. For this purpose, we mounted two cameras way high above the specimen. I think this is about 4 meters up. And we're capturing most of the field of view. Our field of view is most of the surface of the beam. As you can see here, the strands have not been released yet. They're flame cut when two at a time, first the top, then the bottom, and the images have been acquired of the top surface of the beam at these two faces. So these two pictures show the axial strain field when the top two strands are cut and after all four strands are cut. The red line represents a line where we're going to be acquiring the strain data out of the field, and we have plotted them here in this graph. Horizontal axis is the distance from the edge, and the vertical axis is the longitudinal strain. The dots represent the raw data, and the solid dark line represents the some average values. The linear trend initially shown and then the constant trend after some point is also evident. This area, the first the distance where the linear trend is observed, this can be also considered to be the transfer length. The problem has been validated, the system has been validated also with comparisons through finite element models of the test. And here we can observe that the comparison between the finite element and the DIC measurements are in good agreement. The results are in good agreement for the strains and also for the displacements. Even the change in the displacement in the area where the of the transfer length is observed. Here's another validation. We are looking at a four-point bending, and here is a moment at the midpoint of a concrete tie. The tie is also equipped with LVDTs and strain gauges for comparisons. So the tie has been loaded to 20 keeps, and this is right below the design strength. And what we see here is a longitudinal strain on the concrete beam or the concrete tie. The graph to the right shows the longitudinal strain profile along the cross section at the midspan. And we can clearly see how the strains vary from compression to tension. These dots represent the values of the strain gauges, which are outside the area of interest located at these points. And it's clearly seen that when these values are extrapolated, they're in agreement with the values of the strain gauges. The graph below shows the horizontal axis, shows the load versus longitudinal strain. And a comparison between the DIC values as extrapolated at the location of the strain gauge with the strain gauge. Again, the agreement is obvious. This shows a comparison between the displacement at the midspan and the displacement at the LVDT points, and as computed by LVDTs and the DIC. And once again, the agreement is evident. Last validation is a system mounted on an aerial platform on the drone. These are very lower resolution cameras because of some payload limitations that we have at the time. There's an onboard color camera, wireless transmission, and the drone can fly either in a fully automatic or manual flight control, and also has a feature recognition and GPS control as needed. Each of these modes can be activated during the test. The beam now is loaded in steps, in increments. There are load holes at different points, and has been also decided that we will be doing some harmonic excitation on the tie at two levels of loading, just to see how the system performs, the DIC system performs. So here we see the drone, oops. So here we see the observer's view. This is what the observer sees. The drone is flying. This is the onboard camera of the drone. This is right before failure. And here is what the DIC system on the drone captures from the on the beam. Here's our team. So you can see that the drone is completely autonomous. It transmits data to the operator. So, and here's the comparison. Pretty good, actually. The deflection at the midspan is compared using an data obtained from an LVDT, as well as data obtained from a stationary system that captures the deformations on the opposite side of the beam. So here we see that the two DIC systems, the stationary and the drone-based system, they compare very well. And the LVDT measurements, which are taken at the center line under the beam, fall right in between. This small difference indicates that there may be some rigid body rotation taking place, since the drone DIC takes images on one side, the stationary DIC on the opposite side of the beam, whereas the LVDT is right under the center line. This slide here shows the cracking, potential for cracking, as captured by the drone on the front side and the stationary system on the back side. Notice that these are flipped. So this is the left side on the drone. This is the left side of the stationary system. And the cracking pattern is the same. Finally, validation of dynamic loading. The solid line represents the LVDT measurements. The circles is the DIC measurements. And the dashed lines represent an estimated noise margin. And we can see that the DIC tracks the LVDT quite accurately. So talking about now implementation of the DIC in three different areas. The first is material qualification, and deals with testing either the concrete or even rock samples, as we see here, for mechanical properties, in particular modulus of elasticity to assurance ratio, in addition to the strength. So a core is taken out of the rock. It's placed in the compression testing machine. The surface of the cylinder is speckled, and we use the sprayer actually to do the speckle pattern on this one. As the load is applied, the deformations are captured, and a gauge is identified, where now we can see the strains are relatively uniform. Here we see the longitudinal strains and the transverse strains to the specimen. So once a gauge is found, then we can plot the longitudinal strain versus the normal stress. And of course, linear regression will provide the modulus of elasticity of the specimen. But in addition to the mechanical properties, we can see other effects, like the effects of the smoothness, let's say, of the base or the geometry, the geometry of the specimen, where we can see some localized effects taking place due to the fact that the seating of the specimen is not in perfect contact. In addition, there were some specimens that also had some internal defects that were not seen on the surface before testing. Yet, when DIC is applied, we could clearly see the weak plane, and this is where actually the specimen failed. So, although the initial specimen was seemed to be perfect, there was some weak plane. So, it can be also used for assessing the quality of the specimen to be tested. Next application is at a production facility, a major concrete tile manufacturer. And the objective here was to map the surface strain field on a pre-stressing bed. So this is a continuous pre-stressing bed that holds 8 tiles per cavity. Concrete is poured, surface is prepared, and the surface is speckled. Because of the size of field of view, the cameras had to be about 17 feet above the surface. So the best way to do this is through a lift, and the cameras, you can see the boom here, and the cameras would mount on the top about 17 feet from the specimen. Here is the set of cameras pointing down at the specimen. So we monitored half of the ties, so these 4 ties, and here are some details on the system. And the lighting that we used. I'm not going to go into too much detail other than the fact that we used 9 megapixel cameras and 12 millimeter Schneider lenses. And calibration images, we use a 12 by 9 dot pattern, 14 millimeter dots. Another important thing is that 50 pairs of images were acquired at each state of experiment. The reason why we do the multiple images is averaging, image averaging produces low noise and increases the accuracy. So this is the strain field, longitudinal strain field as obtained for the 4 of the 8 tiles in the cavity. And following the standard process where we plot the strains along the lines along the length of the tie, we can see the strain profile, which is not quite as expected. Did a finite element simulation of the problem that even the finite element simulation matches these results. Of course, this non-expected strain field is attributed to the form effects. So when we monitor the just the cavity where we assume that everything is perfectly symmetric, the strain field assumes the symmetric form as shown here. However, when the pre-stressing bed is included in the finite element model, the finite element shows a strain distribution that it's very similar to what was captured by the DIC measurement. So we believe that this is one way of implementing DIC in fabrication facilities to assess the quality of the pour. In addition, we use this data to estimate transfer lengths, and it turns out that the transfer length varied from tie to tie. We did this by fitting a bilinear curve with error minimization to define the intersection. And when we compared the transfer lengths as obtained through our system with an independent evaluation on a large sample of different ties, you can see the agreement. Finally, product qualification and performance. We can implement the DIC system on the standard ARIMA sequence of design tests. Here we're just going to demonstrate a few setup, one of the initial setups in our lab for positive moment rail seat. This is a data acquisition and controller. This is the DIC station. You can see the cameras looking at the specimen, no other instrumentation on the specimen. So as the load increases and we're started at 55 kips, we can see the strain field, the first indication of a crack appearing as the load increases, a second crack shows up, the crack propagates, a third crack shows up, the strain field gets even higher, and eventually we have failure at about 90 kips of load. When we look, when we remove the color map of the strain, we can clearly see the cracks, and I just highlighted the cracks with a red line here just to show the location, and you can see how well it fits the DIC prediction. Here is another case where we tested the specimen in fatigue, center negative, close-up view of the speckle. Here's the DIC system show, pointing at the specimen. And first we moved to 90% of design load and cycled to 3 million cycles, taking a specimen every almost 500 cycles. And you can see that the strain field remains unaffected. Then a crack is induced, and we repeated the, we continued the cycles to 6 million. So we restarted at zero cycles, but now the crack is already in place. And we can see here that as number of cycles accumulates, then although there is a crack, that the crack does not propagate. And this was on the reduced modulus concrete that we developed through, through another project. Post-fatigue, so once the fatigue cycles were in place, then we started increasing the load to failure. And eventually we can see the cracks forming and failure of the system. So in conclusion, first of all, this DIC system can be applied in other areas, and some of the ongoing work that we're conducting, we're using DIC for air neutral temperature measurements, for longitudinal stress measurements, monitoring and assessment of railroad bridges and other rail structures are using the drone mounted DIC, but also monitoring the 3D track movement due to environmental effects. DIC has a number of benefits. First of all, it provides a 3D stereo vision system that provides fast and cost-effective full three-dimensional shape, displacement, and strain field measurements. It's a versatile, non-contacting, stationary or drone-based system with all the advantages of these, and has been successfully applied to product development to monitor the quality and performance from material to final product and beyond. Can monitor also the quality of the production process, and it's highly accurate and reliable results can be implemented in both the laboratory, production facility settings, and the field. I'd like to acknowledge, first of all, Federal Railroad Administration, who has partially funded the work of using DIC in our different projects, and our industry partners, CSX and Correlated Solution, who is the company behind the DIC system, faculty, graduate assistants, undergraduate students, and the lab personnel who have worked over the years on projects that use DIC systems. Thank you for your attention, and here's my contact information if you would like to discuss this further.